So we are going to start the second panel discussion and continuing from this morning. It's also a very, very important topic, how to attract young women to scientific careers. That will really keep us going. So it's a very, very important topic. So back to Usha.
Thank you, Tanushri, and thanks very much to CNRS, CEFIPRA, and my wonderful co-chairs for putting together this exciting program. So we are at the bottom of the pyramid if you look at how it is that the young generation of high schoolers and grow into picking choices for their career. So we want to tap right there. And I am delighted to have my panelists with me, my co-chair, Dominique Chandesris. And I will try to moderate the discussion. So just to get things going and give you a landscape of what it is that we've been thinking of, I noted down some pointers. Now I need to find my presentation. Right. So these are some issues that which we are just going to broadly touch upon. Perhaps some which will be touched upon multiple times have already been touched upon. The first thing is we need to, I thought it's very important to build awareness. I'm usually very loud. to build awareness on science as a career. So many of you would realize that if you look at the young generation, I'm talking about those who are in their teens right now, including perhaps Virginia's son, who's 18, and others, you know, are they really choosing science as a career, male or female? So that's an issue which was bugging my head. You know, everybody, if you ask a 12-year-old or 13-year-old, they'll say, I want to be an architect, I want to be a banker, I want to make pots and pots of money. I would rather work in here or there, and even, you know, because that's what they're seeing in the world around them. Why is science not a rock star career? Is it not so? I think it is possible. It is possible to catch the imagination of the students in schools and colleges, and we need to increase the percentage of students who are choosing science as a career. And when I say science, I mean very broadly. And I think we will be touching on that in several different ways, the way mathematicians are doing it in India, the way physicists are doing this in France, and the way engineers, and we have a very young generation engineer who's going to tell us how they're doing so. The other thing is we need in this session to also discuss methods to break preconceived notions. We've talked about these, you know, unconscious biases, and these unconscious biases are setting in very, very early. So what can we do at the school level? What can we do at the level of counselors and family to, you know, sort of quell this information that science is boring, science is difficult, science is drudgery, and science is not a well-paying career option? So many students who are high school students in will be going with these sort of thoughts, buzzwords in their mind, perhaps planted by their counselors, somewhat planted by their family maybe, and therefore they get discouraged from going into this real tough position. What we need to highlight is how can we make the passion become the most important thing for them. We need for them to know that doing science as a career allows you to follow your passion and pay attention to that. If your passion is to design bags, then yes, you better be the best bag maker that there is. If your passion is to do science and you're inspired by physics of dark matter or dark energy, then you better pursue that. Not to worry too much about what the others are doing and what is fashionable right now. For that, what we need to do is publicize incentives which are present, schemes which are present, and so on. So the question is how. So many of my colleagues have thought very deeply about it, and they're going to give their perspectives from the French as well as the Indian perspective. I think the current generation communication is very, very different than the way we communicated with each other. 120 words, is it, the tweet? limit, 130. So in 130 words, you have to capture their mind, body, and spirit. And if you can do that, then that's good. So we need to learn too. We need to ask them what's their problem and why they're not choosing science as a career. And we need to establish, for those who choose science, we need to establish peer groups. We need to establish mechanisms for peer groups to learn from each other. An example which is working beautifully in India is called the India Bioscience Initiative. So where once a year, there are people who have just started as investigators, their first time investigators, are brought into a conference. They learn from each other, they discuss with each other, they know how one solved a problem, the other actually learns from that. And postdoctoral candidates who are aspiring to be faculty are also invited to this. So allow the peers to learn from each other. And us dinosaurs in the science career path, we can work in advisory teams. So I'm going to move on to let Dominique make a short statement.
Yes,
and then we move on to
In two words, I will present myself. So I am a physicist. I have been working in condensed matter physics. And I entered CNRS in 77. And I just wanted to say something in respect to what said Martina. When I entered CNRS, there was 20% of women physicists at CNRS. Now, I am retired now, there are 22%. So the difference is 2% for 40 years. So you can make the evolution. Okay. So now I am working a lot at the French Physical Society, and I am in charge of the committee Women and Physics at the society. And as a president of this committee, I am present at every meeting of the board of the Physical Society. And I think it's very important that in different boards, you have one person who is in charge of the question of parity or equality who is present. It's just enough to be present. If you are present, the people have in mind that they have to care about equality and parity. And just two words about what we are doing at the French Physical Society. We have some action on mentorship for physicists. And I think it's a very important action, but it's limited to a very small number of persons. And I see the next step, but we will discuss perhaps at the end, will be to have this kind of mentorship for all the students and the PhD students. And the second action that we had is to adopt a charter for gender fairness at conferences. So the goal is to reach the percentage of women in the domain. So if it's physics or mathematics or biology, it can be different. So in the conferences committee, the same number for the invited speakers, for the oral presentation, and we ask also to present these percentages at the closing session of the conference. And so this is a way of working at the society. So a conference will not get a subvention for the society if they don't sign this charter. So now the idea is to have this charter adopted by the European Physical Society, and it's not yet adopted. It's not so easy to have discussions with other countries. So I will stop here. I have not a very important experience in the intervention in schools or things like that, but we can discuss with all the other speakers.
Thank you so much, Dominique. And it is a very, very important point that she's talking about, because it's absolutely the last point that I said.